Godot Tutorials is not sponsored by or affiliated with the Godot game engine. Welcome to the Dopamine and COMT Gene episode. My name is Josie and I'll be your guide for this episode. I also have a website at godottutorials.com, so please feel free to check that out. I am not a biologist nor am I a researcher. I simply enjoy learning by reading books and research articles. I'll go over some of those on my website and in this video. This episode is for inspirational purposes and to set up future episodes that dive into game design. In this episode, I will be going over the following. Why learning about dopamine is important to game design. A quick refreshment of the brain, followed by a quick refreshment of the prefrontal cortex. Then I'll look at the heart of this episode, which is a discussion of dopamine and the COMT gene. After, I'll investigate the potential abuse of dopamine overload in the brain. Lastly, I'll end this episode with the idea that what was once fantasy will now become our reality. For that, I'll be looking at the Metal Gear Solid 4 game. Let's start with why understanding dopamine is important to game design. Dopamine is the body's way of regulating motivation in people. As game designers, it will be up to us to manage how we can make games that players want to keep on playing. We will take a look at this in a little more detail in a future episode, but when that episode comes, you'll see that dopamine is a key ingredient to getting players to enjoy playing our games. Let's move on with the refreshment on the human brain. The brain is made up of neural pathways that can transmit both electrical and chemical messages. The brain uses neurotransmitters, which is considered as the brain's chemical messengers. One thing about the brain is that the wiring of our brains is predetermined by sex. In this case, women have shown on average to have more dopamine neurotransmitters than men. This is an important fact to note as dopamine is the body's way of getting us motivated to do things. So, what exactly does this have to do with dopamine? Well, before I get into that, let's do a refresher on the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is where we plan, make decisions, anticipate future consequences, resolve conflict, and orchestrate our own thoughts. It's what allowed Homo sapiens to surpass the Neanderthals through the early days of evolution. Basically, all high-order cognitive functions happen in the prefrontal cortex. On top of that, the prefrontal cortex is where dopamine is created and managed. It's where we manage our internal reward and punishment system. This leads us to dopamine. Now again, dopamine is a type of neurotransmitter. It communicates with our brain cells and encourages them to act in a pleasurable, excitable, and euphoric way. Dopamine is a self-produced chemical that acts as a motivator, and in essence influences our behavior. One thing to note is that scientists rely on dopamine to measure the addictive potential of any type of experience. The more dopamine the brain produces, the more addictive the experience. One fun fact is that the brain processes both pleasure and pain from the exact same place. In a sense, we can consider the euphoric feeling of pleasure as the brain's reward system, and we can consider pain as the brain's punishment system. Basically, our brains are constantly and actively balancing both pain and pleasure. If you want to look at it a little deeper, your body's pain and pleasure receptors act as a type of homeostasis for your body. To summarize everything discussed so far in terms of dopamine, if you want someone to act or behave in a certain way, make the result pleasurable. However, if you want someone to avoid a specific behavior or action, make the result painful. Okay, so let's learn more about the COMT gene. The body needs a way to regulate dopamine in the body, and the COMT gene provides the instructions for making two types of enzymes that remove excess dopamine in the body. They are MB-COMT, which resides in the brain. The other is S-COMT, which resides in the liver and blood. MB-COMT has a higher affinity for dopamine, and is more important for inactivation of dopamine because most of the dopamine you'll experience will come from the brain. That's not all. The way your body creates the COMT enzymes also determines how effective your body and brain are at reducing dopamine. See, here's the thing, the body can create COMT made up of either valine or methionine. COMT enzymes made up of valine are 4 times more effective at eliminating dopamine than COMT enzymes made of methionine at the codon 158 location. Sadly, whether your body creates fast or slow COMT enzymes made up of valine or methionine respectively, is determined by your genetic code. Most people can produce a combination of both, while the other few can only produce slow COMT enzymes or produce only fast COMT enzymes. This has some pros and cons. So, people that only produce fast COMT enzymes can handle the highest levels of stress and dopamine created from stressful environments. This is because they can remove dopamine from the prefrontal cortex at faster and more effective rates, therefore improving their ability to plan and execute. The negatives of having only fast COMT enzymes is that they need a lot of dopamine to feel motivated to do something. This is in comparison to people who can only produce slow COMT enzymes. The positives are that people that produce slow COMT enzymes need less dopamine in the body to feel motivated to do something. This is great because they can work on things for longer periods of time with less dopamine in their system than others. The negatives are that they will overload on dopamine more easily in stressful environments, therefore freaking out easily and having a slower time to react, plan, and execute. So, what exactly creates dopamine? Well, there are several things. Pain, pleasure, stress, testosterone, and estrogen have an impact on how much dopamine the brain produces. Basically, due to the brain's wiring and hormonal production, there are biological differences with what motivates both men and women. Keep in mind again that women have on average more dopamine transporters in the brain than men. This leads to an important discovery for psychology. Men and women are motivated by different things in different ways. In the next episode, I will look more into the differences in motivation by sex. For now, let's look at some subtle differences that can be found between the two sexes. On average, women require less motivation to do something or start something, and therefore can work on something for longer periods of time. This contrasts with men, who have less dopamine transporters in their system on average, and therefore require more motivation to do something and work on it for a shorter period of time. Let's segue into sports, as the differences in motivation will become apparent. In sports, men and women are motivated to win in different ways. Keeping in mind about the dopamine transporters, since men need a push due to their lower levels of baseline dopamine, you need to scream at them, tell them they are worthless, to do better because they are better. Basically, you need to create a stressful environment in the locker room for them to build up their motivation. If you hit the right amount of dopamine in their systems, they will plan and execute better and faster than if they had lower levels of dopamine. Now let's look at women. In sports, due to women having a higher baseline of dopamine in their brains and having more dopamine transporters, you cannot scream at them to produce that stressful environment you'd pull off with men. Keep in mind stressful environments add more dopamine to the brain, and since women have higher levels of dopamine, along with more dopamine transporters, and on top of that, the fact that playing sports already adds natural stress as an environment, you would need to take a different approach. To motivate women's team in sports, you just have to ask one question. That question is, so, what do you think? Due to women's ability to pick up on the subtlest of body language cues, you will also need to deliver that question in a relaxed and non-judgmental way. The primary reason for asking this question is to just keep the team calm, as they are already highly motivated, and they just need their natural high levels of motivation utilized in a productive direction. If you are a coach or team captain, then getting their motivation redirected to a more productive direction will get them pushing themselves into winning. This question gets them problem-solving their own predicament and pushes them to force themselves to do better, all without you having to add any input except when they ask you questions. Higher levels of dopamine are great in a competitive environment because it gets people planning and executing at faster and higher levels, which is greatly needed in sports. Contrast that with men, who since they start with lower dopamine levels, need that extreme push to get those dopamine levels raised. Therefore, giving them the same higher levels of dopamine women can more easily reach to start planning and executing at higher levels. For now, let us segue into the potential for abuse. In essence, dopamine can be created from pleasure, pain, and stress. The potential for abuse comes in the form of overloading the brain with dopamine. If you overload the brain with dopamine, you can override the brain's natural ability to plan and execute. In a sense, you can override the brain's ability to make careful, calculated, and meaningful decisions. Naturally, when making games, this is a good thing. Think of a game like Pokémon. Pokémon touches on dopamine hitting the brain at appropriate times, whether intentional or unintentional. When you catch a Pokémon, and that pleasurable theme plays, that's a dopamine hit to your brain, because it feels good to capture a Pokémon. When you level up your Pokémon to a new level, and that pleasurable theme plays, that probably also made you feel good. When you see those stats increase on your Pokémon, that probably also felt good to you as well. When your Pokémon evolved, when you found that new Pokémon in the wild, when you defeated the gym leaders and trainers, when you played the casino games and earlier games, those all probably felt good to you. Because they touched on some important game design concepts, one of them being the ability to make you feel good for accomplishing specific tasks that were core to the game. The potential for evil is through gacha games. They use similar concepts to the original Pokémon games. The thing is that they give you a little taste of those pleasurable experiences, like leveling up your characters, or perhaps capturing new types of characters. Then what they do is add a roadblock to your progress, therefore slowing down or even halting your enjoyable playing experience. However, there is a simple solution: pay money to continue feeling that pleasurable gaming experience. Allow the player to play unobstructed, and eventually, rinse and repeat the roadblocking experience on the player. through careful and calculated game design. You can in fact create a game that is addicting, and more importantly addicting enough to keep players paying money to play those games. Eventually, over time, the player without even knowing it, will have spent tens, hundreds, or even thousands of dollars playing a gacha game. I will take a look at compulsion planning and game design in another episode. This leads us to the fantasy turning into reality right before our very eyes. I want to talk about the Metal Gear Solid 4 game. In the world of Metal Gear Solid 4, soldiers were equipped with nanomachines that could monitor and enhance their performance on the battlefield. For this episode's purpose, let's just look at the ability of nanomachines to suppress stress, which basically means that the nanomachines can control dopamine levels of soldiers. Now, this game was released in 2008, however it started production either on or before 2005. That was quite a while back. Can you believe that in 2005, the idea of creating soldiers who use nanomachines to suppress dopamine levels was considered science fiction? Well, this is no longer the case. In 2012, two women named Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna created the award-winning precise genome editing technology that will revolutionize how we edit human genes. That genome editing tool is called CRISPR. It is both amazing and scary at the same time. Basically, both Dr. Doudna and Dr. Charpentier opened up Pandora's box. Genome editing was considered science fiction in the past. Some may have even said that it would be impossible. However, CRISPR allows us to edit genes by simply injecting people with what's considered a programmable blueprint that can change your genes. The actual way is that CRISPR sequences are transcribed into RNA sequences capable of guiding your body's DNA system into matching the CRISPR sequences. In layman's terms, it's revolutionary. Here is a very simple example. Let's say you want blue eyes. All you need to do is inject someone once or twice with the genetic blueprints, and you'll see their eyes change over time. Other examples include halting muscular dystrophy, changing colors of plants, changing cells to have immunity to cancer. If you can find it in the genes, you can make it happen. The problem is you will need to know which specific gene you are targeting and how you'd like to change it. So, what does this have to do with super soldiers who are not concerned with stress? Well, we know that the COMT gene is what regulates the brain's ability to manage stress, and we know which gene to edit to produce the best possible enzymes for dopamine regulation in the brain. Codon 158. What was considered science fiction in 2005 is now considered within our reach. Now I mentioned Pandora's box. What did I mean by this? Well, again, with great good comes great evil. In 2016, the USA Director of National Intelligence issued for the first time ever that genome editing was to be considered a tool and weapon of mass destruction. The reason is that, over time, the technology will get to a point where you can pass these genome editing tools through water, food, and even spread it through viruses and bacteria. Speaking of viruses, if you can, I recommend watching the documentary on Stuxnet called Zero Days. It's a movie where the United States government wanted to basically target one specific computer component that the Iranians held in their isolated nuclear facility. It's an amazing feat of malware engineering to create a computer virus that self-replicates, deletes itself, and is seeking for a single and specific computer and will not activate until it reaches it. Now imagine that with CRISPR, a genome editing tool connected to a virus that is built to target only one specific human individual and does not activate until it reaches that individual. You could shut down that individual's ability to reproduce, ability to see or think clearly, even activate a gene to start Alzheimer's. On top of that, genes carry both our ethnic and ancestral information, which is called genealogy. So let that sink in for a moment. Technically, we are not at the level capable of something massive like the Stuxnet computer malware, but the potential for advancements in technology to get us there for genome editing is real. However, I don't want to go over that can of worms. If you are interested in learning more about CRISPR, genome editing, and the cans of worms it opens as technology advances, I recommend the book called The Code Breaker that talks about the CRISPR genome editing tool and about Dr. Jennifer Doudna. It's a great read and it lights a candle of hope in me on where society and humanity is heading. Anyway, let's look at the homework for this episode. For this homework, all I want you to do is play a gacha game. Pick one that is free to play and intriguing to you. Play it up until the point you feel like spending money on it. When you reach that point, delete the game and write down all the reasons why you like the game and why you felt the need to spend money on it. If the game was boring, write down all the reasons why that was. Stay safe, stay healthy, and be careful. Well, that's all I have for you in this episode. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for subscribing and liking this video. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.